Thank you, Marlene. Good afternoon, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. What I will do now is actually elaborate more in detail on one aspect that was already mentioned by Luca in the first presentation. That is the activity modus operandi and actually the rationale is behind of the Islamic Development Bank in Southern Eurasia, as I prefer to call the region that is known as Central Asia and the Caucasus. I actually published a paper on that last year, which you can, I brought some hard copies, you can take it there in both English and Russian. The reason why it interested me is that I spent myself quite some years in the sector of humanitarian assistance, which is not a core activity of the Islamic Development Bank, but anyway, if you are working in a number of operational contexts in that sector, you are being confronted with the presence of an institution like that, which is by itself rather unique. Why? The Islamic Development Bank is actually the only International Development Bank, the membership and modus operandi of which is defined by confession, by religion. There is no equivalent in Roman Catholicism, there's no equivalent of it in Hinduism, to name but two examples. Which does not mean that these belief systems have no channels of soft power, but in any case it is not institutionalized in a permanent development bank. Second, what you also see is that it somehow reflects the role that development assistance plays in international relations. It's all too often overlooked, but it is a core element, or it is actually a very an element the importance of which should not be underestimated, of international relations and soft power. Now, another characteristic of the Islamic Development Bank, which was founded in 1975 under the aegis of the Organization of Islamic Conference, and have 56 members, among which the six Muslim majority states in Southern Eurasia, who adhered between 1992 and 1996. You have actually the confessionally defined membership, but at the same time you see it's a very hybrid structure. You have that unique aspect. And then you see that it actually recycled quite some institutional and operational elements of classical international financial institutions like the neighbors here, the IMF and the World Bank. A lot of it is inspired on the World Bank, and they have also an internal virtual currency that is inspired on the system of special drawing rights within the IMF, which they call the Islamic dinar. So, anyway, a further characteristic, if you look at the capital structure of the Islamic Development Bank, is that you will see that the largest individual shareholder of that institution is Saudi Arabia. Ah, that reflects already something in terms of who is trying to build some sort of soft power through multilateral institutions. And if you take all the member states of the GCC and the GCC bloc, you see that they, in terms of shares, hold about more than 40% of the shares of the Islamic Development Bank. Another major shareholder with close to 10% in 2012 was Libya. But in the meantime, this size has shrunk to a bit more than 3% due to the delicate circumstances in Libya that we all know. So you see basically that the IDB and its work in Southern Eurasia is no exception, is actually a channel of soft power and of economic implantation of the GCC economies, most of all the most prominent among them being Saudi Arabia. Now let me now elaborate on a few characteristics of the work of IDB in the Southern Eurasian region. The first thing is that you see, if you compare them to other donors in the region, that its input is more a supplement to that of the classical international financial institutions and to that of donors from the OECD. That means the classical Western industrialized countries and then Japan. Nonetheless, you see a prominent presence in a number of operational niches and sectors, which I will mention in a moment. A second characteristic is that the Southern Eurasian countries, six economies, six societies, actually receive much more from IDB than their own input, the latter of which stood at a bit less than 0.5% in the year 2014. On the other hand, contrary to that input, you see that the Southern Eurasian region was good for 5.1% of IDB investments worldwide. That is actually of minor importance in the overall portfolio. The main recipient for information of IDB capital and IDB investments for the moment is Egypt, with almost 19% of the banks in investments. 19.19. A third characteristic is the sectoral distribution of IDB activities in the five Central Asian countries plus Azerbaijan, which is actually my my main country of work for the moment. If you analyze the sectors in which the IDB invests in the region, then you will see that transport and energy infrastructure and water infrastructure takes a bit more than 80% of the investments of the Islamic Development Bank in the region at the moment. So that is a clear concentration on that specific niche and that specific activity, which is actually compatible to a number of priorities set by the governments or member states in the region itself, and also because it is being perceived as the substructure, the key sector on the basis of which regional integration in Southern Eurasia can be achieved. The second sector in which the IDB is most active in the Southern Eurasian region, with 11% of investment in the last reference year, is the banking sector, the finance sector. And then, of course, that brings us to the very specific activity of the promotion and elaboration of a system of Islamic banking in the five countries itself. And then the third sector is healthcare, with 3%. A fourth characteristic is the country-wise distribution. When you analyze the investments of the Islamic Development Bank per country, you will see that the largest recipient was, according to this figure and still is, Azerbaijan. In a few moments, I will come to a number of reasons why that is. Then followed by Kazakhstan and then by Turkmenistan. What is important to actually keep in mind or remember about that. That is that there is actually no correlation between social needs and the degree of poverty and actual IDB investment in a country. Because the three concentration countries in the region that you see, Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan and Turkmenistan, are actually, in terms of income, more in the upper notch of national income of the region, largely driven because of revenues from the extractive industry. Now, which objective factors explain the dynamic or the choices that the IDB make and then the activities in the region itself? A first point that I want to mention is that the IDB is certainly a channel of soft power of Saudi Arabia and other GCC economies in the region, due to their sheer share in the capital structure of the bank. With what is that explained? Is that an ideological mission? You could think so because of the confessional definition and character of the Islamic Development Bank and actually the organization, the framework of which it was founded, the OIC, but there is much more. Actually, you see that a number of investments fit perfectly in the tendency of the GCC economies, Saudi Arabia, UAE, Qatar, etc., to diversify their economies away from an overdependence on the extractive sector and then in the first place oil and gas. And they do that already for years in a number of sectors. That can be banking, that can be the agro-industrial sector. One translation of the latter is the way that Gulf-based companies buy up land in Kazakhstan, other countries as well, but specifically in Kazakhstan in the region. That is the first thing. A second explanation related to Azerbaijan And that explains also the quite high degree of interaction between Azerbaijan, the OIC, and the IDB, at least according to regional standards, is that the Organization for Islamic Conference, which is actually the mother organization of the IDB, you can say in a way, the IDB is a specialized institution under the OIC, well, Azerbaijan could mobilize quite some support, political support among IDB member states and through different OIC channels for its stance in the frozen war in occupied Nagorno-Karabakh. A further factor that makes actually interaction between Southern Eurasia and the IDB as a donor interesting, which is an objective interest, has to do with aid conditionality. And I think this is a very important, important aspect. Because what you see is that donors from the OECD generally tend traditionally to put a number of conditions, attach a number of conditions to their aid. That can be a number of economic conditions, but very often this came at conditions in the terms of democratization, human rights, etc., which is absent in the conditions of grants and loans given by the IDB. This does not mean there's no conditionality at all, but the conditionality that there is more of sheer economic nature. Further on, one of the goals of the IDB is to promote trade between its member states. And when you analyze the patterns of foreign trade of the six Southern Eurasian states, you see that the degree of trade within the IDB region is rather high. That is explained, that can be explained with the fact that actually trade with each other within the region is very important, and the same goes with Turkey, which is also an IDB and OIC member country. A further factor explaining the interest for increasing cooperation with structures like IDB has to do with a development model. And I would not immediately refer to confession in that, but what do you see is that among the incumbent state elites and economic elites in Southern Eurasia, there is definitely an interest for the development model of Abu Dhabi, Dubai, and Qatar. And what is specific about that development model? Well, in short, it actually shows perfectly that you can go for modernization, opening your economy, and get access to all the trappings of globalization and international or global consumerism, without having to adopt a political model inspired by the Western European or Anglo-American political model. Whether the latter two will actually work in Southern Eurasia is another question, but on which I will not elaborate right now. A further characteristic that has been suggested or mentioned already by Luca, that is actually the channels through of aid transfer. The IDB is not delivering its aid through what is generally called, in development parlance, civil society and non-state actors. It is basically, it are basically aid transfers between a multilateral organization or intergovernmental organization and recipient governments. Also of importance in taking decision or transferring aid or making certain choices for projects are, as Luca already mentioned, the informal networks. The informal networks that are embedded in state structures. The example par excellence that I'm thinking about that is a specific concentration of a number of social projects financed by the IDB in Tajikistan in the region of Dangara, which is the district of origin of the president of Tajikistan. No doubt, these informal interactions between representatives of IDB, of IDB heads of state, and the incumbent elite in the recipient country have influenced a number of choices. Last but not least is also the ever more active role of Kazakhstan, not anymore as a recipient of aid, but as an aid donor, which it has officially become, and in the capacity of which it is being recognized. I mentioned actually two examples. That is IDB assistance to, or that is actually Kazakhstan's participation in a structure under the IDB, which was founded and launched in 2006. That is the Islamic Solidarity Fund for Development, which is an initiative or a structure specifically concentrating its efforts on social development, and of which Kyrgyzstan is one of the beneficiaries. And then a second example that underlines the ever stronger position of Kazakhstan as a donor country and not anymore as a recipient country, that is a 2 billion IDB support that was given in 2014 for the period 2015-2017 for multilateral multisexual activities in the framework of Kazakhstan's role in the creation of the Islamic Organization for Food Security. Actually, that Kazakhstan take the lead in such an in this specific in this latter fund is also not surprising as well, given the fact that Kazakhstan is not only an oil and gas exporting country, but has also been profiled itself since a number of years as a net exporter of grain. Which is a lucrative sector, given the increase of food prices since 2007 and 2008. So I will leave it at that. These were a number of things that I wanted to share or thought important in order to give a concrete image of a very specific aspect of interaction between the southern Eurasian countries and the GCC region. If there's any questions or remarks or details you want to elaborate on, I'll be glad to answer it in the forthcoming discussion. Thank you.